Welcome to another edition of Unfettered Freedom, your weekly GNU/Linux news video podcast. Packing so much freedom into each episode, it ought to be illegal. If I packed any more freedom into this podcast, I would have a disheveled appearance and I would pick at my feet. On this edition of Unfettered Freedom, Blender 2.90 has been released, and it is an impressive release. It makes me want to learn Blender, maybe one day. Also, Thunderbird, they now have OpenPGP enabled by default. We're also going to discuss a really nice free and open source alternative to something like Google Authenticator. We're going to talk about FreeOTP, which is an open source two-factor authentication application. Also going to discuss the Arch Wiki's list of applications page. Now this is really fantastic for new to Linux users. The Arch Wiki has a list of applications page where they break down some of the most popular applications available. Also, Hurricane Laura and the several days that I went without electricity and some of the lessons I learned going through what I did with that storm. All this and more on episode 5 of Unfettered Freedom. I am your host, Derek Taylor, also known as DT or DistroTube on YouTube and on Library. This podcast, as well as all of the video content on the DistroTube channel, it is community sponsored. And because of the community support that I receive, there are no corporate sponsors or product shilling of any kind in these episodes. And I can think as I please. I can say things that need to be said. In short, I can be independent, and if you'd like to support my work, I'd greatly appreciate it. Please subscribe to DistroTube over on Patreon. And our first story is going to be the big release of Blender 2.90. So Blender is a really neat 3D modeling application. It's for creating animations and really cool stuff like that. I've never really used Blender myself. I've always wanted to learn how to use Blender, and every time they have another release and I keep seeing this thing improve and I see some of the amazing things people can do with Blender, the more I want to learn about it. And the other thing we should also mention about Blender is it does have the ability to edit video. You can actually use Blender as a video editor. I don't know how well it does video editing because that's not really the main purpose of Blender, but it does have that capability. So one of the things that immediately impress me is those of you watching the video version of this podcast, when you go and look at the release announcement for Blender 2.90 from Blender's website over at blender.org, it's not just plain text on a mailing list. It's not just the same old release announcement that you typically get with open source software releases. This page is full of animations and YouTube videos demonstrating some of what you can do using the Blender software. I mean, this page just is, it's amazing. It's a gorgeous website, as you would expect. The kind of people that use Blender, no doubt, would be very good at web development as well. It's just a very well put together release announcement page. Some of the new features and improvements with Blender 2.90 include things like now they have this physically based texture for simulating the colors of the sky. This feature is called Nishita. They also have improved motion blurring, improved shading to avoid that blotchy appearance that you can sometimes get. They have NVLink support now for CUDA and optics. So, of course, that's for your NVIDIA cards. You really need powerful graphics cards, really, to do some of the 3D modeling and applications like Blender. That's one of the things that sometimes people really don't take into account with things like video editing and 3D modeling and animations and things like that, is because they're so graphically intensive, you actually do need a pretty decent GPU to get the best performance out of these applications. Some other notable changes in Blender 2.90 include a new interactive search menu, drag and drop reordering of modifiers and other stacks, scene statistics available as an overlay in the 3D viewport. There is a new lens distortion model, and various other features. One other one that just jumps out at me is that there is now initial Wayland support. Probably not great Wayland support. Most people that do things with graphics and especially video, if you're recording video especially, Wayland is not ready at all. It's nowhere near ready. You kind of have to still use X11. We're going to be using X11 probably for another decade or two on GNU/Linux, unfortunately, until, you know, Wayland has to come along a lot further. Right now, I don't even think you can, like, capture your screen, you know, video capture a screen using Wayland. Until we can get some of that basic stuff working, X11 is going to be around forever. Blender 2.90 is free and open source software. It is available on Linux, of course, because Linux free and open source software, of course, is a first-class citizen. But Blender is also available on proprietary operating systems like Windows and Mac OS. You can grab the latest versions of Blender from the Blender.org website. For those of us on Linux, if you run a distribution that has systemd, Blender 2.90 is available right now as a snap from the Snap Store. And I mentioned that Blender is one of these pieces of software that I have wanted to try out forever. I have wanted to actually learn Blender for a long time, and for whatever reason, I've just been putting it off. And, you know, I really want to get into maybe doing some animations and things, maybe, you know, for purposes of my videos. I just think it would be cool. What if I created, you know, an intro to my videos or an outro to my videos, some kind of animation, you know, using Blender? I think that would be a neat little project to work on, because I think me learning Blender would be a cool thing to document on the channel. You know, as I learn Blender, I can show you guys that are also interested in learning Blender maybe how to use Blender. That might be something I get into maybe here in the near future. And our next story is the new release of Thunderbird now has OpenPGP support, and that's enabled by default. OpenPGP, of course, is encryption for your email. Now, I have been a Thunderbird user for years, almost since the beginning of Thunderbird. So I've been using Thunderbird for a long, long time, but I've never used encryption with Thunderbird. I've actually never used encryption with any email because I've never found the need, because I don't typically email anything that has any kind of sensitive information in it, because email, by its very nature, is not secure. Because the people that invented email, I mean, email was invented so long ago, it really predates modern computing, it predates the web by many, many, many years. So they never had security or privacy in mind when they invented email. So just know that email, I don't think, will ever be secure. But if you want to encrypt your emails, OpenPGP is a way to do it. And Thunderbird had OpenPGP in several releases prior to this, but it wasn't enabled by default. And the big deal now is, starting with version 78.2.1, OpenPGP is enabled by default. For those of you that are able to run Thunderbird 78.2.1 or later, the way you get to the OpenPGP key manager is you have to go to the tools menu, and you get to that by clicking on the little hamburger menu on the right side of the Thunderbird window. Now, most of your Linux distributions are not going to have 78.2.1 or later in their repos just yet. Most distributions, of course, are static release distributions. They typically are not shipping the latest and greatest software. On rolling release distributions, you may have a hard time finding Thunderbird 78.2.1. You can always go to the Mozilla website, go to the official Thunderbird website, and grab the latest 32-bit or 64-bit binaries. On Arch Linux, I noticed that the Thunderbird package available in the standard Arch repos is still on 68. It's the 68 series. And the reason is they have been asked to not package anything until the 78.2 release. So Arch has been stuck on 68. For a while. Those of you that want the latest releases, though, on Arch, you do have a couple of other options. There is a Thunderbird beta package in the AUR. It's actually called Thunderbird-beta-bin. That's a binary. And that really gives you the very latest cutting edge features, but pretty good stability. It's not the nightly builds. Those of you that want the Thunderbird nightly builds, though, that is also available in the AUR. That is located as Thunderbird-Nightly-Bin. And again, that's a little bit more bleeding edge, and that's for people that want to look at the latest and greatest features being added, and they don't mind Thunderbird breaking on them occasionally. And our next story is about this really cool free and open source two-factor authenticator application. Because really, you should be using two-factor authentication wherever you can. Any service that asks you to enable two-factor authentication, you really should do it, because passwords can be cracked. With enough time, anybody can crack a password. So with stuff, especially services that have very sensitive information about you, you really should enable two-factor whenever possible. So the one downside to two-factor authentication for those of us that want to use free and open source software is the application that most people have to use to enable two-factor authentication is the Google Authenticator. That is like the standard application. And obviously, it's a Google application. Most of us don't want to be tied to Google any more than we already are. And it's not free and open source software. And, you know, all of your mainstream big online services are going to ask you to enable two-factor authentication. All the various Google services, Facebook, Twitter, any big social media platform, they're all going to ask for you to enable that two-factor. And they typically just tell you to go get the Google Authenticator, and that's the way you do it. Well, there is a free and open source alternative to the Google Authenticator. It's called FreeOTP. It is free as in freedom. It is licensed under the Apache 2.0 license, and it is developed by Red Hat. Now, I know some people have a problem with Red Hat. A lot of people in the free and open source software communities, for whatever reason, don't trust Red Hat because it's a billion-dollar corporation and, you know, it's got to be evil because they make money. Well, I trust Red Hat a lot more than I trust Google. So I will use Red Hat's authenticator program before I use Google's. And I've always used Google's because I didn't know there was an alternative until I came across this blog post the other day. I didn't actually know this application existed, and I am just thrilled by this. It is available on both Android and iOS devices, and to use the application, it's just like any other authenticator app. All you do is scan a QR code, and that activates your two-factor authentication on whatever website you were trying to activate that on, and then it starts to automatically generate security codes every 30 seconds for you. By the way, I'm an Android user, and I did notice that it is also available in the F-Droid store, so that's great, because if you're an Android user and you're looking for free OTP because you want to get away from the Google Authenticator, you probably are also not using the Google Play Store. You're probably using the F-Droid Store. And I love the fact that free OTP is in the F-Droid Store. For those wanting to check out the source code for free OTP, the source code is available and published over on GitHub. And really, the bottom line is, you need to use two-factor authentication. We really have to these days because, again, just using a password, you're asking for trouble. Most large websites, most large online services are eventually going to have a data breach. Really, to be honest, things like Facebook and Twitter and all of that crap, you really shouldn't be on those services because they get hacked. Or if they haven't been hacked, they're going to get hacked. And if you put sensitive information on those social media sites, which you really shouldn't be doing, you know, you're just asking for trouble at that point. But if you have to use sites like that, at least enable two-factor authentication. It won't save you from when the online service as a whole is hacked, but it will at least prevent you, you know, the individual, from being so easily hacked. Because I see way too many people, you know, get their Google accounts hacked or Twitter accounts hacked, and they wonder why. You know, how did I get my account hacked? You know, what was your password? You know, and it's something like 1234 or the word hello. It's like, really? I wonder how they guessed that. The next story I want to talk about is really just a page straight out of the Arch Wiki. The Arch Wiki has this really cool page called the List of Applications. And it is a lengthy page. It has a very long table of contents, but it's basically a list of hundreds of various applications that are available in Arch Linux, but probably in pretty much every other Linux distribution as well. And it just breaks it down by category. And if you're new to Linux, you know, you just coming to Linux for the first time, you just came from Windows or Mac, and you're wondering what is available. Even if you don't run Arch Linux, go read this page because it's fascinating. And I mean, let's just go ahead and pick a category to check out. I'm going to check out web browsers because I have no idea what kind of web browsers people use on Linux, because I come from Windows and I'd been using Microsoft Edge for the last few years and Internet Explorer before that, and those browsers aren't available. What do I have? Well, it looks like I have about 7 or 8 different terminal-based web browsers if I wanted to view the web on the command line. There's also various graphical-based web browsers as well. So you have this broken down by what engine they use. So if it's based on Gecko, you have Firefox and SeaMonkey and various Firefox spinoffs like GNU IceCat and LibreWolf, the Tor browser, WaterFox. You have the various Blink-based web browsers. Of course, we're talking about Chromium and all the Chromium spinoffs like Brave, Ungoogled Chromium, Opera, Vivaldi, you know, all that stuff. I think one of the most common questions I get, people ask about desktop environments and window managers. And if I go down to chapter 7.5, desktop environments, actually, let's go to 7.5.1, window managers. And what window managers are available? Well, they actually have so many window managers available, they didn't list it on this already very lengthy page. They have a link to a list of window managers page. And you can see that there are at least 50, 60, I don't know. There's a lot of window managers available for you in the Arch repos. So this is a really great page here, the list of applications pages. So if you're wondering about audio players, video players, terminal emulators, even networking stuff, system admin tools, whatever it is you do with Linux, this list of applications page probably has a heading for that type of application. For those of you that watch the video version of this podcast on YouTube or on Library, I will link to this list of applications wiki page. Again, if you run a GNU/Linux distribution, it doesn't necessarily have to be Arch. I think you probably want to take a look at this page. So the final topic that I want to discuss is the last week. So those of you that have been following me on the YouTube channel know that 1 week ago, when I published Unfettered Freedom Episode 4, when I published that right before I did, I also posted over on my YouTube community tab that my area was about to be hit by a hurricane, and I was just warning everybody, hey, I don't know what's going to happen. I may be without a power for a little while. I don't want you guys to worry, though. I'm not really near the Gulf Coast, so no storm surge or massive flooding or anything. I shouldn't have to worry about that. But with these storms, typically there's massive power outages, and I was letting everybody know that I might be away for a few days or even a few weeks. So if you go to my YouTube community tab, you know, I posted a picture of the satellite image of Hurricane Laura just before it came ashore near Lake Charles, Louisiana, Cameron, Louisiana, down in the southwestern portion of the state. Now, I live about 3.5 hours from that area inland. I'm actually in the northeast section of the state. But this storm, really, initially, it didn't look like it was going to amount to much. They were predicting it might be a Category 1 or Category 2, you know, earlier in the week, and then this thing blew up almost to a Category 5 in strength right before it made landfall, you know, 150 mile per hour sustained winds, which actually tied it for being the most powerful hurricane to ever strike the coast of Louisiana. And we are not immune to hurricanes, right? We get a lot of these storms. But Laura was really quite something special as far as the strength. And typically when these storms move inland, you know, they lose strength rather fast. And I often get these storms, you know, when they hit the coast as Cat 3, Cat 4 storms, you know, those really strong ones. By the time they get here, they're typically tropical storms. And, you know, the winds are not as much of a concern. Really, for us, it's the rain, because the area I live in is very flood prone, because I have a lot of rivers nearby, bayous all throughout the city. And if one of these tropical storms move through and then they sit there for a while and just dump rain on us for a couple of days, much of the city will be underwater. People will lose their houses in that case. So it's really the rain we're typically worried about here in this area. We typically don't have to worry about strong wind events, but this thing, Laura got here in such a hurry. She still had quite the punch when she got here. She was still a Category 1 hurricane, I think, at the time, maybe closer to a Category 2 hurricane. There were some very powerful winds. I was standing outside trying to save some of my stuff before it blew away. You know, it was blew a door off the carport, and it ruined a wood fence we had outside. It just blew it away, just shattered it. It was crazy, the wind. Thousands and thousands of downed trees. I've never seen anything like the damage that this did. And it's, I mean, I've been through tornadoes. I've seen what they can do. But, you know, tornadoes impact small areas. You know, this thing, you know, I can drive hours in each direction and just see tree after tree that's laying down. You know, thousands and thousands of power poles laid down, power lines everywhere. And I spent nearly a week without power after this because my city, you know, I live in the northeastern section of the state. The city I live in is a population about 60, 70,000 people. It's not a small town. It's the largest city in this part of the state. And the entire city was without power there right after the storm. It was crazy. I mean, no traffic lights, essential services. There's no supermarkets and gas stations. And then when a few came back online, there was such a rush to go get essential items like gas and ice and, you know, things like that, batteries. You couldn't find extension cords, people trying to run generators. And, you know, I got used to just sitting at home in the heat. It got very hot here. So in this part of the world, you know, especially in August, it's the hottest month of the year. And typically temperatures can hover around 100 degrees Fahrenheit. With the heat index, typically they can get up to 115 degrees with the heat index. Now, thankfully, it didn't quite get that hot. The hottest days were like around 95, 96 Fahrenheit outside, which brought the temperature inside the house up to like 89 or 90 degrees, which is still extremely hot. It's like a sauna in the house. Very dangerous. And you really had to fear for the elderly because when the entire city is without power, you know, how many people really know their neighbors? Most people don't know their neighbors. And that's what worries me is most people know their next door neighbors or the person right across the street from you because you see them, right? You just come across them, you wave to them, maybe you speak to them every now and then, but like 3-4 houses down, do you know that person? No. And what if there's, you know, a lady in her 80s, been living by herself, and she's just sitting there with no central air, you know, generator or nothing. Her house is 90 degrees and she's just laying there. You know, you fear for those people because in that kind of situation, those folks can just go to sleep in their house in that extreme heat and never wake up. You know, is anybody checking on those folks? Unfortunately, after this hurricane, you know, when we start evaluating some of the deaths associated with Laura, many of them are not going to be deaths from the storm because we're going to have people that died from the heat. We're going to have a lot of people that died from carbon monoxide poisoning because of all the generators. Many people don't understand that you can't actually run a generator indoors. It's a gasoline engine, just like your car engine. You know, car engine, you know, puts out carbon monoxide. Same thing with a generator. You cannot run that in your house, but we had people that did that. Families, you know, somebody comes and plugs up a generator in the house, and then the entire family goes to sleep, and that's it. The carbon monoxide builds up and none of them ever wake up. Many people, thankfully, didn't die, but when they did this, it made them very sick. And some of those folks are hospitalized, but thankfully somebody got to them before they actually passed away from the carbon monoxide poisoning. From the storm itself, there were people that were killed because of trees, you know, trees falling on houses or vehicles. And then after the storm, there was just thousands and thousands of trees, you know, many of them in the road. And we had vehicles striking trees. You know, you're going down a highway at, you know, 60 miles an hour and you come up on a tree that's laid across the road. You didn't see it and you hit that tree, you know, going that fast. You can imagine what that would do to a vehicle and the person inside the vehicle. One of the interesting things from me going all those days without power is that I got used to it after a while. You know, those first couple of days kind of sucked. Actually, every day sucked. It was probably the worst week of my entire life as far as just discomfort, just being in the heat. But I had gotten used to not having any electrical device working there for a while. And some of you guys were asking me, how was I taking a picture on my phone and posting it to YouTube? Because I would post every morning, hey, this is day 3 without power, day 4 without power, day 5. And I have people asking, well, how are you even using your phone? How are you charging your phone if you don't have power? Well, I did have a car, right? You have a car charger in your car, right? I hope most of you do. If you don't, you know, make sure you have a phone charger in your car. And it was great because where I was at in this house, I didn't have any kind of phone signal. I couldn't call. I couldn't get on the internet. I couldn't do anything on my phone. My phone was useless there for 5+ days. So what I would do is when I got up early every morning, I would snap a selfie picture, you know, to send you guys, but I couldn't actually send it from here. What I would do is I'd go get in my car and I would drive for like 30 minutes in the air conditioning in the car because I just wanted air, but mainly to charge my phone. And then once I got away from this kind of dead area, because I guess the cell towers around here were all dead too. But once I drove away a few miles, I could actually use my phone. I could get on the internet on my phone, and that's when I would post those pictures to YouTube. So that's how I did that. I was surprised so many people were concerned about how to charge the phone. There's actually multiple ways to charge a phone. You also have those charging banks that some people keep, and those things last forever. But I actually am kind of happy that my phone didn't work all those days, you know, at least while I was in the house, because I would have just been sitting there playing on my phone because that's all I could do. But instead, I was out in the yard, you know, cleaning up the mess out in the yard. I even mowed one day. I actually push mowed my yard in the heat, knowing I couldn't come inside and relax in any kind of air conditioner. But it was like, I don't know how long this is going to last. Is it going to last another day? Am I going to be without power another week, another 2 weeks? You know, the yard's got to get mowed. So I just worked around the yard and cleaned up the house a little bit. Things that maybe I would have done anyway, but many of them I wouldn't have done because I had other things to do, right? When the world is normal, well, I can go play on the internet. I can go do my YouTube stuff. I can go to the gym and work out. I couldn't do any of that during this episode. And when the power finally came back on and I could be normal again, I could do my normal routine, it was weird because it's like I had gotten so used to not having to do YouTube every day or go to the gym every day or do this every day. You know, it was almost like I was a different person when the power came back on. And that was why when the power came back on, you know, I spent a few hours cleaning things out. You know, I had a deep freeze that I lost all our food. I had to throw everything out. And that first day I decided I needed to make a video just to make sure I got back into the swing of things. And there was only one video I thought I needed to make because it made the most sense. I mean, what's the one thing that kind of defines me? Arch Linux. I made an Arch installation video on the first day back just because. I thought maybe if I did that, things would start seeming normal again. And you know what? It did help. One interesting part of this week, though, was, you know, after 5 days without power, I was really getting tired of the heat, sweating, just constantly pouring sweat. You know, the heat down here is unbearable, mainly because of the humidity. And after 5 days, somebody had told me that, hey, Home Depot just got in a shipment of generators, a large shipment of generators, because there's so many people without power. And they've got enough generators for anybody that wants one, if you want to go buy one. And generators are not cheap. You know, typically they're going to cost you at least $800, you know, more than $1,000 for some of the better ones. So I went down to Home Depot. I was like, okay, I'm tired of sitting in the heat. I do have a window unit for an air conditioner. You know, I can't run central air and heat off of a generator because it draws too much power, but I did have a window unit. And that's perfect because, you know, I could just sit in the room with the window unit and cool off a little bit. And I thought it would be worth it. If I went and spent $1,000 on a generator, it would be worth it just to have that window unit up and running. So I went to Home Depot, bought a generator. And I was coming back home and I had the porch lights on outside. I'd flipped them on. That way I would know if the lights were back on when I came back, and the porch lights were still out. So I knew power was not back on. So I was like, okay, well, I'm glad I purchased the generator. So I back up so I could unload this generator. And as I was coming in the door of the house, I hear the noise of the power coming back on. So luckily, that $1,000 generator I bought, I didn't even need to unload it. I just left it in the car. I returned it the next day, you know, still new in the package. And I thought about keeping it because of the future storms that may or may not happen. But it's such an expensive piece of equipment. And I just didn't think that it was worth it for me to keep it. If I had small children or something like that, or I lived in an area where massive power outages for days or weeks at a time were common, I might have, but this was a very unusual event. This was really like a once-in-a-lifetime kind of storm. One thing I did do, though, in preparation for the future, is the National Guard was passing out water and MREs to everybody because, you know, the entire city's out of power. You're talking about, like in this parish, 100,000 people, you know, everybody was out of power. So the National Guard comes in, they're giving out food and water, whatever you need. You just wait in line, the line of cars. You get there, you tell them how many people are in your family, and they give you whatever. They gave me like 5 cases of water and 4 cases of MREs because I asked them, hey, could I have some for my neighbors? You know, it's like, while I'm here, can I pick up some for next door neighbor, guy across the street, whatever? And the National Guard doesn't care. They give you as much as you want. And it's, sure, we'll load you up however much you can carry. So I got like 5 cases of water, 4 cases of MREs, gave it all away except for 1 case of MREs. And I never opened it because I didn't need to. I didn't feel like eating an MRE. I've eaten some of them before. They're not great. But I am going to put back that 1 case of MREs that I still have just in case, just for the next storm. Because these MREs, of course, last years. So I will store that away just in case I need it in the future. And that is it for this edition of Unfettered Freedom. This was episode 5. I try to release Unfettered Freedom on a weekly basis. I try to release every Thursday. Again, I am your host, Derek Taylor, also known as DT, over on YouTube, Library, and Patreon. If you guys want to help support my work, please consider doing so. You'll find DistroTube over on Patreon. Before I go, I do need to thank the producers of this episode. I need to thank Michael, Gabe, Corbinian, Mitchell, Devin, Fran, Akami Channel, Chuck, Claudio, Donnie, Dylan, George, Caleb, Devils, Lewis, Paul, Scott, and Willie. These guys, they are my highest tier patrons over on Patreon. Without these guys, episode 5 of Unfettered Freedom wouldn't have been possible. Those of you watching the video version of the podcast, all these names you're seeing on the screen right now, these are all my supporters over on Patreon because, again, this channel is supported by you guys, the community. Again, look for DistroTube over on Patreon. All right, guys. Peace.